All right. Hi, everybody. We're going to go ahead and get started. So my name is Ashley Janelle. And before I jump into this talk, I just want to say thank you so much to the Juneteenth Conference for having me and allowing me to speak and talk to you guys about UX, and happy Juneteenth. So let's jump right into it. So today we're going to be talking about why you're not getting that UX role. What's going on? Are you going out for interviews? Are you working on your portfolio? What's happening? We're going to talk about it. So we're going to jump right into it. So before we get started, I want to talk a little bit about who I am and why I'm qualified to talk to you guys today. So I'm Ashley Janelle, a UX UI designer at Caterpillar. Also the creator of Learn UX Online in 16 Weeks, which is an online course that allows you to learn UX. You build your portfolio, you work on various projects, you build up your skill set, your confidence, and we help you go out and actually land that UX role. In terms of education, I attended Columbia College Chicago and got a BA from there in Interactive Arts and Media, which was really a mix of web design and graphic design. And then after that, I found my way into UX, and that's how I'm here today. A few past roles prior to Caterpillar, I was a visual and UI designer at Redbox, as well as a graphic designer at Motorola Solutions. So all of my work prior to Caterpillar has been design related. Caterpillar, as well as Redbox, are my roles that are UX specific. So let's go ahead and keep going. So again, a little more about me and kind of, you know, why I'm qualified to talk to you guys about, you know, why you're potentially not landing a UX role. Like I mentioned, the UX course, I do a lot of coaching. So I'm talking to a lot of aspiring UX designers every day, working with aspiring UX designers every day. So I hear it all. I understand I once was a UX designer or aspiring UX designer. But I understand that I came from the route of having a college education in interactive arts. So a lot of the people that I talk to, a lot of the UX designers that I work with, they are coming over from a ton of different fields, accounting, teaching. So it really doesn't matter, you know, what you're currently doing. If UX is something that you want to get into, you can definitely get into it. I work with people every day. Did some teaching with STEM students, helping them get into careers in STEM as well, and more mentoring. So this is, you know, outside of Caterpillar, this is what I do, and this is how I've got the knowledge to kind of talk to you guys a bit today. So I've compiled the top four things that I've seen really hurt UX designers or aspiring UX designers when they're actually trying to go out and get that job that they want. It really comes down to four things. The first thing is your portfolio. Obviously, we know that portfolios are what, you know, helps you get your foot in the door. It's the first thing that someone sees when they open up your application. They jump right to that portfolio. They probably don't even really look at your resume because they want to see what you can do. So what is a winning UX portfolio? That's what I call it. A winning UX portfolio is the one that gets you right into the door and gets eyeballs on your work. What is a winning UX portfolio and why do you need one? So a UX portfolio is a compilation of your work. Obviously, it contains detailed case studies of UX design projects demonstrating your skill sets and approach, okay? Employers will use this obviously to get an understanding of who you are, what your skill set is, and then obviously ultimately decide if they want to bring you in. So again, your portfolio is extremely important. Everything from your landing page to your interior pages being your case studies. Your portfolio is just, I mean, it has to be top notch, and I always call it winning. It has to be winning. It has to be eye-catching. It has to be visually pleasing. It has to be you know, it has to tell your story, tell your case study story in a way that is digestible, but that's also very thorough. Designers also use this time as an opportunity to allow their own personalities to shine through. So you can think of your portfolio as your online presence. So, you know, if you're someone who you know, loves color. You put that into your portfolio. If you're someone who, you know, really likes, you know, more of a black and white kind of style, you know, this is really your time to let your personality shine through your portfolio, okay? It's a time for you to really, you know, start working on your personal branding, you know, what you want people to know about you once they open your portfolio. And you obviously, as a designer, you know that you can do all of that with design. So where can putting together this winning portfolio go wrong? Okay, there are a few different ways that I typically see. So portfolios that don't clearly present your work and showcase your skill sets are really working against you, and they're not working for you. Okay. And so what do I mean by that? We have case studies that we add into our portfolios, and that's what employers are looking at when they're trying to decide, okay, who is this person? You know, what do they know? What are they all about? And you know, what is their skill set? What is their level of understanding of UX? And we do that in a very specific way. One of the first ways is showing that you know, understand fully what the problem was that you were trying to solve. There are a ton of ways that we can do this in portfolios, but that's the first thing. You really want to make sure that, you know, someone's reading your portfolio. It's really like a story. There's a beginning, middle, and end. So having a clear understanding of what the problem is and showcasing that, very, very important. And this is where I see a lot of people miss. The next thing is showing actually how you solve your problem. So obviously there's a UX process, there's a formula that we essentially, you know, work with when we're trying to solve problems. So you want to make sure that you're documenting that. You want to make sure that you're going in order in your case study, which is the order that you actually, you know, conducted the project in. You want to show exactly each step that you did, why it was, you know, probably why it helped you. Maybe you did something in it, maybe it didn't help you. You want to talk about those things. You also want to share your work in artifacts. So if you take a look at the left-hand side of your screen, you will see this is kind of like a sample portfolio. And you'll see on the top, that's a persona, which basically is an artifact or a graphic that shows a lot about a particular group of people. We put it into one person. But this persona, Lauren Holmes, can be several different people that you may have interviewed or surveyed. But we just kind of batch it all into one person so that you can really get a good understanding of who this person is and what they like to do, what their interests are, what their needs are, their goals, those kinds of things. If you see below it, that's a storyboard. So that's how we actually can tell the story or illustrate a story for someone who is not familiar with the problem that we're trying to solve. So there's several different artifacts that we use methods that we use in UX design. And then what comes out of that is your artifacts. And those are going to be the key things that you're going to add to your portfolio. So you want to show your work and then make sure that you're adding that into your portfolio as well. The last thing is to showcase your final UI in a very compelling way. So your final UI design, you know, whether it is a tablet, a desktop, mobile, whatever it is, you want to make sure that you do that in a very compelling way. Make it interesting. Make sure that your UI design is, you know, is pixel perfect. Make sure that you've gotten feedback on it. And make sure that it really compels or really conveys what it is that you're trying to show. So here's some sample UI designs for desktop, mobile, and tablet. And you can see how it's laid out there in a way, you know, that's interesting. It's visually pleasing. And this could be maybe your header when you actually land on your case study. There are tons of different ways to lay out a page. It just really depends on where you are in your case study. And I just want to make sure that you don't forget to include a variety of devices. I see this a lot. You know, if you have worked on an application and maybe it was just for mobile, maybe that was the ask, maybe that was the challenge, or maybe that was the client that you worked with. Well, go back and develop something and design something for tablet and for desktop as well. You know, your portfolio, again, it shouldn't just be, you know, this is the work that I did. Make sure that you're going above and beyond to actually, you know, showcase that you have a skill set and you have the range. So the next thing is experience. Okay, so what is experience? What do I mean by experience? So experience is just that. Any work that you have, you know, completed in the fields of UX research, UI, strategy, you know, anything that is related to the field of UX design is experience. Anything that you've done, any projects, any freelance projects that you've worked on, any pro bono work, that is all experience, okay? And as an aspiring UX designer, this experience is usually something that you can package and put into your portfolio, like we just talked about. So one of the biggest questions is, how can I get experience? Well, one of the first ways that people get experience is, you know, a lot of people take some sort of a UX course, and in that UX course, you should be able to have projects that you walk away with and be able to put into your portfolio. Another place that you can get experience is side projects. So, you know, maybe you give yourself a project, or maybe you work with a friend or something like that. These are different ways that you can, you know, actually beef up that portfolio. So what happens when you have a lack of experience, and what does that mean? So I know that, you know, pretty much depending on any industry that you've been in, you've all seen something that says, you know, they're looking for a junior designer, or they're looking for someone that's kind of junior, but they want them to have like 3, 4, 5 years of experience. Well, it's like, how do you do that? You know, freelance projects and pro bono work are a really great way to show that you have experience. When you take on pro bono work and when you take on freelance projects, you are working with a client. So this is a really great way to get out of your own head. You can actually have someone, you know, if you're working for, you know, a freelance company, or maybe you're doing some work pro bono for maybe a not-for-profit, they're actually giving you the problem, what it is they want you to solve. You're talking to their customers, their users, and then you're solving a product for them that they ultimately have to buy or have to, you know, have to like, have to enjoy. They have to accept it, you know, when you're done. So it's not something like a side project where only you can say when this is done. No, you actually have someone that you're working with and potentially working for that can really give you that structure and guidance. So interviewing. This is one of the next ways that I really see a lot of aspiring UX designers just, for lack of better words, not know. For a lot of people who, you know, this might be your first stab at a creative role, interviewing could be tough. There are a lot of questions, and, you know, it really just takes a lot of practice and understanding of ultimately the work that you did to get to where you are. And I'll explain that in a moment. So what does a typical UX interview look like? Typically, one of the first things that you do is you'll have a portfolio showcase where you will actually showcase the work that you've done. You might walk through a project. The interviewer may have picked a project that they want you to show. And then you'll talk about it. So you'll, you know, give a rundown of, you know, maybe one or two projects. They will ask you interview questions, which we'll talk about in a second. You might meet the team. And then you will also have the opportunity, just like in most interviews, to interview the interviewers. So, you know, ask them questions. You want to know about, you know, exactly, you know, what does their company look like? What does the company culture look like? What's the expected growth opportunities for this particular role? Make sure that you're asking those questions as well. And then oftentimes there is a design challenge that they want you to do, maybe at home, or maybe you've done it before you actually get to the in-person interview, or maybe not, depending on, you know, how things are with the actual company. But there might be a design challenge that they want you to do where you actually are solving a problem for that company so they can see how you work, see what your skill level is like, and things of that nature. So one question that I pulled, because I think that it's an important one, and I just really want to break down exactly how these go, because there is a right way and a wrong way to answer a lot of these questions. So one question that a lot of interviewers ask is a question that goes like this. What is your typical workflow? Now, to be able to fully understand, to be able to fully answer this question, you have to understand what your workflow is. So, you know, whether you've taken a course or whether you've kind of, you know, read up on, you know, actual UX workflows and whatnot, you won't really be able to answer this question. And that's how a lot of UX questions are structured. The questions are in the details of actually, you know, what a UX designer does. So there's really no way to fake the funk when it comes to these questions. But what you want to do is you want to explain your approach to projects and how you go about problem solving. So your goal here is to really take the interview through your journey, the interviewer through your journey to problem solving. So, you know, you might talk about, you know, one of your projects, give an example of one of your projects that you did, and how you, and why that approach was maybe different than a typical approach. So you really want to make sure that you're diving into the details, obviously answer the question, then take one of your case studies or your projects or an experience that you've had and really use that to dive into the details to really be able to explain exactly how you would go about your typical workflow. So another question, how do you incorporate usability testing back into your work? Again, this is another question that is strictly built on, it's in the details. You wouldn't be able to know how to answer this question if you've never usability tested before. If you've never worked with users, if you've never tested anything, if you've never written a script, if you've never written a usability report, if you've never taken a usability report and said, okay, what things are we actually going to cherry pick and actually, you know, what are we going to put into this phase versus what, you know, maybe doesn't need to be touched at all versus what might go into next phase, you really wouldn't be able to answer this question. So that's the first thing. So obviously making sure that you have a clear understanding of usability testing, but like I mentioned here, you want to explain your user testing process and how you pick and choose the items you want to include versus not include, okay? And then again, as always, give them an example of a time where you did this. Again, maybe there was a time that stuck out because it was different than the others and you really had to figure out, okay, you know, what are the key things that we have to get in for maybe this release, or maybe there's a second release and we can, you know, include the other things. You know, talk about a time, you know, give them some examples, give them something to go off of. There's a textbook answer, but, you know, they may ask a follow-up question like, so tell me about a time. So just go ahead and throw it in there so that they know exactly, you know, that you know what you're talking about. And then the fourth thing that I see a lot of UX designers struggling with, they're trying to do it all alone with no guidance along the way. So you're trying to learn UX and you just don't know what to do. I get this all the time. Where do I go? What do I read? What do I study? What do I watch? So I want you to think about the following statements. And if you can relate, just say it out loud at home. Say, I can relate. If you have little to no experience when applying for jobs, if you feel like we talked about experience, if you feel like, hey, you know, I've been giving myself projects, but maybe I need a little bit more experience. If this is you, you know, say it's me at home. If you're trying to find the time to dedicate to learning UX while working a full-time job, if this is you, say me or raise your hand at home. Not knowing what should go into a UX portfolio. There's a lot that goes into a UX portfolio. There's a lot of different ways that you structure portfolios to tell a story. There are things that you want to include to show that you are eager about the next phase of the design process. There's a ton that goes into UX portfolios. If you have imposter syndrome, so you might feel like, man, you know, UX isn't for me. It's for those super smart people, the people that know how to design, the people that are really good with strategy and good with interviewing people and talking to people. You know, those are the things that we tell ourselves that keep us from actually moving forward with what we really want to do, which isn't good. And then also, you may not know what part of the UX process is for you. So obviously, you know, there's UX research, someone who just focuses on, you know, talking to users and really understanding the product or the service, really understands how people are using it, collects data, does a lot of the usability testing. You might be more design focused, or you might be more into the strategy. There are a ton of different, you know, UX related roles, and maybe you're just not sure which one is for you. So where can you get this kind of experience? I would definitely recommend a UX course where you can get a really structured way of learning UX so that you're not kind of going about it in a roundabout way. Or maybe, you know, another thing that I see happen a lot of times is when, you know, people don't know where to go, they end up, you know, maybe reading articles or watching YouTube videos and nothing really comes of it. They look up and maybe it's 6 months later and they have nothing to show for it. Well, of course, it would really help you get a structured outline and, you know, gives you an end date and things like that. And, you know, what to expect at the end of, you know, X amount of weeks. So that's a really great way. It's a very streamlined process. The other is partnering with other aspiring UX designers. There are a ton of people out there that are in your position. And sometimes just working together with someone else can really give you the boost that you need. And you guys can attack projects together. So, you know, don't always think that you have to go at it alone. You know, if you know someone who's interested, maybe partner up with them. So lastly, I just want to say that if you are an aspiring UX designer, you know, good luck. I hope that, you know, something in here resonated with you. If you would like to stay in touch, please do. You can email me, find me on Twitter or Instagram. And I also have a Facebook group, the UX Career Accelerator Group, where we talk about all of this stuff. And there are hundreds of aspiring UX designers in there. There are hundreds of people who have been in UX for a while. And we're all in there to share knowledge and help each other get to the next phase, whatever that is for you. So connect with me. Make sure that you, you know, drop me, you know, a DM or something, letting me know that you saw this talk and, you know, let me know, you know, what you need help with. Or just come in Twitter, hang out. We like to crack jokes on there. And yeah, you know, stay in touch. Again, thank you very much. Thank you, Juneteenth Conference, and happy Juneteenth, everybody.